Right.
Well, good evening, everybody. This is an exciting program tonight, the Manitou Mysteries, the Shipwrecks of the Manitou Islands. As my family and I used to backpack there on the North Manitou Islands, so I'm really excited to hear this. Our presenter tonight is Ross Richardson. He is author and shipwreck hunter and has been researching shipwrecks and solving mysteries for 25 plus years. He is here tonight to share some of his stories. And I just like to remind everybody that I will be giving the special summer reading code at the end of the program. Again, welcome everybody. And here is Ross Richardson.
Well, thank you, Renee. And thank you everybody for coming to learn about some Michigan shipwrecks. If you have any questions, we're gonna have a question and answer period at the end of the program, and feel free to use the chat feature to write your questions down, and we'll unmute at the end of the program and have a great time talking about the things we'll learn tonight. Let's start the evening off with a prayer. God be good to us, for thy sea is so great and our boat is so small. Now, you probably recognize that prayer. That is the Breton Fisherman's Prayer. It's an ancient prayer. And President Kennedy had this plaque on the Resolute desk in the Oval Office. Now, nowhere are these words more our Great Lakes. Vast, beautiful, and dangerous. The first recorded shipwreck is LaSalle's Griffin, which sailed to oblivion in 1679. The most famous shipwreck, and what many consider the last shipwreck, and definitely the largest, was the sinking of the Edmund Fitzgerald, which broke at Lake Superior, November 10th, 1975. In nearly three centuries between these two shipwrecks, historians estimate between 6,000 and 12,000 more shipwrecks occurred, which cost over 30,000 lives. Now, these are devastating numbers. They're almost beyond comprehension. But those of us who plied the Great Lakes know they are more than just near lakes. They are inland seas, beautiful, but fraught with danger. My name is Ross Richardson, and I am your guide to tonight's adventure. I am an author and shipwreck hunter. I have a website called MichiganMysteries.com. Now, MichiganMysteries.com is dedicated to stories of missing persons, missing aircraft, and missing ships in the Michigan region. I also have a couple books out, The Search for the Westmoreland and Still Missing. And we'll talk a little bit about each of those books later in the program. Now, I serve on the board of directors of the Maritime Heritage Alliance in Traverse City here. And the Maritime Heritage Alliance is a nonprofit organization dedicated to preserving, interpreting, and sharing the history of the Great Lakes. And this program is one of the ways that we do that. And we'll talk a little bit about the MHA in a couple minutes in the program. Now, I live in LA, probably not the LA you're thinking of when I say that. I live in a little village in northern Michigan by the name of Lake Ann. And if you do the Michigan thing and hold up your hand, I live about in the pinky nail. I'm going to hope a little arrow appears on your screen and you can follow it. So this little bit of light sand right here, that is Sleeping Bear Dune, 3 mile long, 450 foot high sand dune, which is the center point of the Sleeping Bear Dunes National Lakeshore. Now, these two islands here are North Manitou Island, where Renee and her family backpacks, and South Manitou Island. Now, this area of water between the islands and mainland is called the Manitou Passage, and it's very important, and I'll tell you why. In the 1800s, when shipping of goods and people was occurring, the easiest way to do this was through the Straits of Mackinac. And they would come up through Lake Huron and they would have a choice to make. They could go out and around the Beaver Island archipelago right here, but that would add 50 miles to their trip. Or they could take this shortcut through the Manitou Passage, saving time, and time is money. But of course, you're already seeing the problem. Cragged shoreline, islands, pinch point with traffic. And when foul weather would occur, shipwrecks would happen. And many did in the Manitou Passage. And those are some of the shipwrecks we're going to be talking about tonight. A little bit about myself. I am a volunteer librarian at the Elmira Township in beautiful downtown Lake Ann. If you ever visit our sleepy little village, please stop by. There's the whole library right there. It's basically in one room, very small. But a lot of the information you're going to hear about tonight was researched in this library in either our local or regional history section, which is very nice, or online. The Maritime Heritage Alliance. I am on the board of directors there. Now, this is a great organization out of Traverse City. We operate sailing vessels like the Madeline, which is a replica of an 1840s schooner. There she is right there. We just redecked her. She's out on the lakes right now. A beautiful boat, beautiful example of our history. We take her out from port. She's a tall ship. We also have a wood ship where we work on old wooden boats and build new wooden boats, and we operate a number of sailing vessels. We are an all-volunteer organization. If you want to learn more about sailing or learn how to sail these vessels, you don't even have to know how to tie a knot. We'll teach you how to do it. And we also have master wood craftsmen that will share their art with you if you want to help build boats and keep these boats in good shape. So please, if you're ever in the Grand Traverse region on vacation, please stop by the Maritime Heritage Alliance campus. Now, not all the wrecks I find are on the bottom of Lake Michigan. I'm a little bit of a car guy. And this is a wreck I found in a barn in 2016. After 3 years of hard work, that's how she looks. And again, a little plug for our sleepy little village in northern Michigan. If you find yourself vacationing up here in the summer, every Tuesday night we have basically a town festival. So please stop by Lake Ann. We have a brewery, live music, ice cream, and lots of cool cars. But my true passion is Great Lakes shipwrecks. Now, this is a photograph taken by a friend of mine. His name is Cal Kothrati. Cal is an artist and underwater photographer. And today I'm hearing some noise. Somebody might not be muted. If you are not muted, if you could mute your computer, that would be great. I'm hearing some bleed through. There we go. Perfect. So this is a photograph taken by Cal. Again, he's formerly of Milwaukee. He just moved down to South Carolina, but he is an underwater photographer and videographer. And this photograph shows the wreck of the St. Albans, which is over on the Milwaukee side of Lake Michigan. It's in about 150 feet of water. Now, if you look back here, you can see this is 100-foot visibility in Lake Michigan. You can't even see the water. It's almost like air. Now, what causes that? Well, look at the front of the ship here. We see it's encrusted with something. These are quagga mussels. Now, quagga mussels are the slightly larger, slightly more resilient of the zebra mussel. Quagga mussels now represent 99.9% of the mussel species in Lake Huron and Lake Michigan, and also Lake Erie. Surprisingly, they're not in Lake Superior. So these little crustaceans here, they attach themselves to the shipwreck and other things, and we'll get into that. And they eat algae and plankton out of the water. So they make the water very clear, like in this photograph from Cal. This ship is the Ralph Simmons. You probably know it better as the Christmas tree ship. As a matter of fact, there's still Christmas trees in the hold of this vessel from when she sank in 1912. So what's very interesting about this photograph is this is over 100-foot visibility and 160 foot of water in Lake Michigan. So here's the scary part. This dark bottom here, look at these light patches. That's sand. The dark part is a carpet of quagga mussels, which now covers the entire bottom of Lake Michigan and Lake Huron. In Lake Michigan alone, scientists estimate there are over 5 trillion quagga mussels, and they go deep. We know they go at least 500 feet deep. We don't know if they're deeper because we haven't found shipwrecks deeper than that yet, but we suspect they do. So they clear the water up, which allows the sunlight to go much deeper and warms the water up, which of course decays the shipwrecks more quickly. And they're also detrimental to aircraft, air crashes. and the wreckage of those in the Great Lakes. So quagga mussels are here to stay. The good news is we have beautiful clear water. The bad news is they're an invasive species and they are damaging the environment. So there's been a lot of shipwreck news lately, a lot of discoveries and things going on in the shipwreck world. Let's quick page two and take a look at some of them. Jim Sawtell, a Northern Michigan treasure, passed away almost a year ago. A very good friend of mine. Jim was an early scuba diving pioneer, an early shipwreck hunter, but he's probably best known, him and his wife, Nancy, for building shipwreck bar and restaurant interiors out of wood from shipwreck. And they also built this wonderful shipwreck furniture that was very popular in the 60s and 70s in Northern Michigan. We're going to miss Jim. He was a great guy. Shipwreck discoveries. The Atlanta was discovered off of Whitefish Bay in Lake Superior by the folks at the Great Lakes Shipwreck Museum at Whitefish Point. She was discovered in about 650 feet of water. At the top there is a sonar image. She was a 180-foot schooner barge, which sank in 1891. Dave Trotter of Canton, Michigan, announced a great discovery. He is the all-time leader in Great Lakes Shipwrecks discoveries with over 100 discoveries that he's made. He discovered the Water Witch, which sank in the middle of during the Civil War in 1863. Again, beautiful steamer that went down. A couple other boats saw her disappear, I guess. And it was a much sought after shipwreck. So great discovery, Dave Trotter. Mark Gamage and Joe Van Wagenen discovered the Challenge, which sank in 1853 on her maiden voyage. She's a 200-foot long passenger steamer. She headed up to Mackinac Island and some passengers got off, some passengers got on, some freight was taken off, some freight was put on. She left Mackinac Island and her boiler exploded. Now, this was her first voyage ever. The paint was barely dry. She sank in 90 feet of water. Now, she was discovered originally by Paul Ehorn, but he did not make that popular. So Joe and Mark get the credit. The Elva was discovered last summer off Mackinac Island by Dusty Cliffman, Bernie Hellstrom, and Tom Hadfield. And the story is the Elva was built for preacher Henry Bundy in the 1890s, and she would sail the Great Lakes from port to port while Henry Bundy, who was a preacher, spread the gospel. Well, when he was done doing that, he sold the boat to Arnold Transit Company, and this boat was used to ferry goods and people back and forth to Mackinac Island. She was renamed the Elva. In 1954, the Elva was towed off of Mackinac Island and lit on fire as a spectacle to celebrate the breaking of ground of the Mackinac Bridge. She burned to the waterline and sank in 120 feet of water. Here is an image of her right now. This is what we call a burn job. They burn down to the waterline. There's not much to see. It looks like her machinery might have been taken off. She sank to the bottom. But what really strikes me about this photo is look at the quagga mussels. Again, they completely cover the entire bottom of Lake Huron and Lake Michigan. When you get past deeper than 60 feet out of the surf line, you got these huge carpets of quagga mussels. Not a lot of people know that, but it's really changing our environment. Ken Merriman had a couple of great shipwreck discoveries. Ken is a past president and founding member of the Great Lakes Shipwreck Preservation Society. He's also a retired computer engineer. So now he goes around the Great Lakes on his 1947's Owens Cruiser, which is a wood boat. Matter of fact, he's out right now looking for shipwreck with him and a few of the crew members. He was able to discover the Pier Marquette 18, which is the largest still missing vessel in Lake Michigan. She's a 338-foot car ferry, which transferred railroad cars. She was traveling from Ludington, Michigan to Milwaukee, Wisconsin in September of 1910. She sprung a leak mid-lake. They rolled railroad cars off the back of her, about half of them, but they could not lighten her enough, and she started going down more quickly. The captain ordered them to abandon ship. And her fleet mate, Pier Marquette 17, came alongside and rescued about half the crew and passengers. Half the crew and passengers died, including the entire bridge crew. So we don't know why she sank. She discovered her in about 550 feet of water. And there should be an image here. Okay, I'm having a little technical difficulty that happened. So this is the deepest wreck that has been found in Lake Michigan and possibly Lake Huron. Okay, it'll take me a second to get this refired up. Occasionally we have a lot of high definition video and sometimes the computer can be a little finicky over Zoom. So I appreciate your patience. Okay, now I need to share again. And okay, folks, let's see here. Okay, it looks like it's warming up. There we go. So this vessel was found with side scan sonar. That's the tool we use these days to find these deep water shipwrecks. And that is very deep. Okay, so that, I'm getting closer. Oops, hang on here one more second. And okay. And hopefully you can see that. There we go, the side scan image of the Pier Marquette 18. Now, what's unusual about this shipwreck is she sank by the stern and she dug into the bottom. So the bow of the vessel sticks off the bottom over 100 feet. If you could scuba dive that deep, you could go underneath and inspect the bottom of the ship. So pretty amazing. So this sticks up almost like a finger sticking out of the bottom. Take a look at the wreck site through some video provided by Ken Merriman. First thing, we're at the very bow here, which is about 450 feet of water. First thing, it's completely infested with quagga mussels. Quagga mussels like wood, but they love steel. Now we're coming over the railing here and look at that damage. So major damage at the bow. What we believe happened is there was an air pocket in the front that didn't have time to release. The vessel sank so fast, she was so heavy, that she went down with a big air pocket in the front. When she got down 100, maybe 200 feet, the water pressure crushed her like an empty beer can and burst the air bubble out. So causing that damage to thick plate steel, it's pretty amazing. Heading towards the stern, we see the cabins are missing. Cabins are built pretty lightly, almost a 2x4 construction, like on a house. And those don't fare well at sinking and things. They're not meant to be out in these type of things to handle the air and water pressure. So the pilot house was found near the rear. We'll get back and give us more video of that. Another discovery, the dolphin in Racine. Ken Merriman found this last summer at 110 feet. Of water about 10 miles west of the Mackinac Bridge. She sank 1869, I believe. About 10 miles west of the bridge, she was involved in a collision. Now, when they inspected the wreck, they got here to the stern and around the ship's wheel, there was a Burger King watch, somebody wrapped around it. So divers had been here before, but sometimes divers are sneaky and they keep their shipwreck discoveries quiet. I have a discovery I announced a little over a year ago, and the shipwreck is called the Jarvis Lord. And I first heard about the Jarvis Lord probably 25 years ago from this newspaper article from 1885. And it says the loss is reported of the steamer Jarvis Lord traveling from St. Agnes to Chicago, okay, with a load of iron ore, okay, much like the Edmund Fitzgerald. She sprang a leak. And she sprang a leak off the Manitou Islands. Okay, that's in my neck of the woods. They decided to put her up around the beach. They headed towards Glen Haven. And within 2 miles of that place, she sank stern first in 240 feet of water. This is gonna be a piece of cake. I know she's 2 miles from Glen Haven and in 240 feet of water. How could I miss, right? Meanwhile, 8 years later, it's not anywhere near there, it's somewhere else. But I did happen to discover her. Now, the interesting thing about the Jarvis Lord is she was one of the very first bulk freighters. Now, what do I mean by bulk freighters? bulk freighter is pilot house in the front, machinery in the back, and these top loading hatches that can handle coal, iron ore, corn, wheat. And to understand why it's important and why this vessel could carry so much, we need to look a little bit about the history of Great Lakes vessels. Back in the 1840s, 1850s, they came out with this. The steamers were pretty new and they came out with these big side wheel steamers like this one here, the A.D. Patchen. And these vessels were 200, 250 feet, 300 feet long. They called them palatial steamers. And they were operated by steam engines and these side wheels, these giant paddle wheels. The problem is in storms, they were not very good. A lot of times the ships would rock back and forth and one paddle wheel would be buried in the water, the other would be out, and they were very hard to dock. So about 1860, they came out with this design, which is a propeller-driven passenger steamer. Now this had passengers up in these cabins here in these gangways on the side where they would load cargo with hand trucks. Now this cargo had to be put in crates and in barrels. So you can imagine moving iron ore and things like that was very labor intensive. You had to shovel it all into a barrel, cart the barrel onto the boat, lower it down, ship it, get the barrel out, and then dump the barrel, and then dump the barrel out of the contents out of the barrel. So very labor intensive. Now in 1869, they came up with the first bulk freighter, which they just dumped the bulk cargoes right inside. The Jarvis Lord was built in Marine City, Michigan, just 3 years after the introduction of, which is one of the very first late steamers. Now, eventually this morphed into the giant, the pinnacle of design, the Edmund Fitzgerald, which was 729 feet. She was launched in the 1950s. These pictures are roughly to scale. So a historically significant vessel that was all but forgotten about. I'm going to play a news piece announcing the discovery of the Jarvis Lord. So it'll give us an idea of the research, the search aspects, and the documentation of a shipwreck.
There are many Great Lakes shipwrecks that are considered to be holy grails by hunters. We're on board with a group of explorers who believe they found one that sank in the 1800s.
Somewhere off Sleeping Bear Point, hidden within the uneven underwater topography that makes up the Manitou Passage.
The quickest route up to the Mackinac Straits was in between the islands.
Rests a wreck.
It's a smaller version of the Edmund Fitzgerald.
Its final resting place has been a Great Lakes mystery for more than a century.
People have looked for it before.
Ross Richardson is one of them. His side scan sonar captured this image.
I thought, okay, this could be that vessel.
Only one way to know for sure. Get back out there. Go to the bottom. Get eyes on it. With the shoreline behind, four footers in front.
We can do this.
This risky expedition begins.
I'm excited to see what it is. I mean, we've been looking at the pictures and talking about it for 6 months or longer.
After a 30-minute ride,
we are there. It's right underneath us.
The wait is almost over.
Deploy the grapple.
While the anchor drops.
We're gonna wanna let it all out.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
And hooks onto the wreck.
We'll swing around with our bow into it and there'll be enough slack. It'll cushion our ride a little bit.
Diver Steve Weimer gears up for his trip of more than 200 feet.
All right, y'all set? I need a mask.
Beneath the surface. He starts his slow descent to whatever awaits.
Oh, I see his bubble.
Topside.
A regalis with tales of what he saw down there.
Anticipation.
I think it's gonna be pretty cool. One of probably three different vessels, so we'll see. It's the one we think it is, or a surprise.
Almost an hour later, Steve pops up.
Okay.
And makes his way to the back of the boat.
Mass, our land, all over is a big windlass on the bow. The starboard side's kind of intact, but the port side is kind of peeled away and leaning. There is a big boiler type thing. From what I could see, the stern is all collapsed and kind of buried, broken up.
Could you make out a cargo of any kind?
No, I don't, if there was, there wasn't, like, the deck was, like, collapsed. But there had to have been one, two, three, four hatches, big beams, big masts. There was one that was partially sticking up and was broke off.
Is there a break in the hull?
Back on land.
The bow itself is on a 45 degree angle. But
armed with maps, models, and Steve's memory.
It's got to be bigger than a 130 foot schooner.
It is definitely bigger than that.
Okay, so that narrows it down a lot.
Their debrief intensifies.
It's sounding more and more like the Lord, and it's just the back end impaled.
Leading to an identification, the wreck they thought it was.
The Jarvis Lord.
The Jarvis Lord was a 193-foot freighter that sprung a leak and sank in 1885. Luckily, all crew members survived.
That is the first time anybody's seen this since the 1800s.
Lake Michigan still has many unidentified shipwrecks sprawled across its sandy floor.
I would like to find as many as possible.
The Jarvis Lord is no longer one of them.
I've spent some time out there trying to find this.
Brent Ashcroft. 13 on your side.
So shipwreck discoveries, I just love shipwreck discoveries. I'm kind of a mystery guy, and I just love being able to solve, you know, hey, something's missing. Where is it? How do you find it? Which leads me to describing my book, Still Missing, which is based on my website, michiganmysteries.com. It has a few different stories in there. It has a missing person story. This is a missing grocery store manager who vanished in 1969 under mysterious circumstances. This couple in their aircraft, which disappeared in 1977. I threw a shipwreck in there. So I'm a shipwreck guy. And we talked a little bit about the D.B. Cooper case and possible Midwest connection. But let's talk briefly about John and Jean Block, pictured here, and their aircraft. They took off from Macomb County Airport, just north of Detroit, Michigan, to the Lost Creek Sky Ranch in Luzerne, Michigan. Their flight was completely overland. Again, it was July 4th, much like our last July 4th. It was hot, muggy, beautiful weather. It should have been a two-hour flight, and they simply vanished. So they took off from this Green X. John would have came up 75 and around a town near West Branch, he would have went right north to this red net. And to this day, they have not been found. Now, we don't think he's down in this area because it's much too populated. But when you get up here into the Huron National Forest, we can see, you know, there's less than one person per square mile in that area. There's just miles and miles of wilderness. We were contacted by a fisherman a few years back who thought he had some aircraft parts. It was recovered by a county sheriff, and we found it was the side of a pop-up camper. But we were excited that somebody found something and at least had the presence of mind to contact us and, you know, make sure it wasn't part of the airplane. A gentleman contacted us a couple Thanksgivings ago and told us he thought he found something on Google Earth in a swamp miles south of the airstrip. So we spent our Thanksgiving weekend going out, including this gentleman putting his waiters on here. That is Josh Block, the grandson of the missing couple, and he still wants to bring his grandparents home. So we looked at the swamp. We didn't find anything man-made in there, but we came to the realization that there's no way to traverse a swamp like this. The only way to do it is maybe look at it by drone or possibly Google Earth. Now, can you find an aircraft on Google Earth? And the answer is yes. Looks like we have another frozen screen here. Hang in there, folks. Let's see, we'll restart this. Hopefully it won't kick me out again. And so, yes, we were made aware of, and it'll just take me a second to get this back up and running. Sometimes Zoom doesn't like these programs. Okay, we're loading up there. That looks good. Okay. Your screen. And we'll get back there again. I appreciate your patience. So, are aircraft visible on Google Earth that are crashed in strange areas? Well, this is a story. The answer to that is yes. This couple disappeared in 1997, flying from Drummond Island. They were thought to be lost over Lake Huron until 2018, when a forestry worker came across their aircraft. Now, this is pictures of their aircraft. They were still inside the aircraft. It crashed outside a town called St. Ignace, which is on the northern end of the Mackinac Bridge. The remains were recovered and returned to their family. The airplane is still there. So we have a group of people, probably six of us, who were involved in looking for the black Cessna. And we were able to pinpoint this area. Guys that hike and go out in the woods and looked went out there, got the GPS numbers, and looked on Google Earth. And there were times that this plane was visible from on Google Earth in the woods. Now, of course, who would think to look through the woods? Well, we're thinking of that. And we found another aircraft. Pilot disappeared in 89. He was found about 2000 by a couple of bear hunters in the UP of Michigan. And he was still sitting in the aircraft. He crashed in a cedar swamp. And this aircraft is, again, visible on Google Earth during certain times of the year. So we're using that as a tool right now to try to find targets in heavily wooded areas to go out and explore and narrow down the vast Huron National Forest. Now, we're also making a video to share with DNR workers and forestry workers of what aircraft could look like crashed in the woods. Like, that does not look like an aircraft to me. That looks like a car engine, maybe some old aluminum siding, maybe an old deer blind. Who knows? So we're hoping by sharing this and creating awareness that maybe a hunter, a hiker, somebody is going to come across this aircraft, or maybe somebody saw something 10 or 20 years ago and it didn't occur to them that, hey, that pile of wreckage, you know, could be an aircraft that nobody knows about. So we're trying to raise that awareness and keep the story alive. So hopefully we can return John and Jean Black to their family. Oh boy. Wow. Okay, boy, this is crashing a lot. We must have a funky connection here. Usually only happens about once a program. Again, I apologize for this, folks. Let me try something a little bit different here to avoid this. So the search continues for John and Jean Block. Our guys, Jeff and Tyler, still go out in the woods and look for this couple. And we're hoping to someday have some success and return them to their families. Okay. Okay. Now. Hopefully you're seeing the slideshow again. There we go. Again, sorry. So John and Jean Block, they disappeared in 1977, 45 years ago, and we are still looking and trying to find them. A little bit, I'm going to play a little video about another book I wrote called The Search for the Westmoreland. Again, this is in the Manitou Island area off of Sleeping Bear Dune. And it's a story of a treasure ship which sank in 1854. And I've got a little bit of video I'm going to play from the first dive, from the very first dive when she was discovered. Nobody had seen this wreck in 150 years. So let's watch a short video that explains why the shipwreck was so sought after and how many people looked for her.
On December 7, 1854, the 200-foot-long wooden passenger steamer Westmoreland foundered during a winter gale in Northern Lake, Michigan, taking 17 of her crew and passengers with her. 17 of her crew and passengers survived, however, and stories soon began circulating the Westmoreland carried $10,000 in gold coins in her safe and 280 barrels of whiskey in her hold. 2 decades after the Westmoreland foundered, her first mate, Paul Pelkey, returned to search for the ship and her treasures. In 1872 and 1874, newspaper articles claimed the Westmoreland was discovered and salvaged, her engine and boilers delivered to a dock in Chicago. In 1936, 25-year-old Max Knoll and 19-year-old Jack Brown teamed up with an old salt from Frankfort, Michigan by the name of Captain George Waters and launched a search expedition to find the treasure ship. Cap Waters, who actually met the Westmoreland's first mate, Paul Pelkey, during the 1870s, claimed to know the exact location of the Westmoreland. The trio was said to have found the wreck and then used prototype dive gear to dive and explore the wreck site, which they described as a broken-up board pile. The following year, 1937, Jack Brown and Max Knoll founded the Desco Corporation. Desco, the diving equipment and salvage company of Milwaukee, Wisconsin, went on to be one of the biggest diving equipment manufacturers in the world. The 1950s brought a couple more expeditions to find the Westmoreland. In 1954, Captain Harold E. Van Nyman of Flint, Michigan, searched for and claimed to have located the treasure shipwreck. He said the wreck covered and uncovered with the sand and also claimed to have recovered a barrel and had it sent out to have its contents analyzed. Sadly, the following year, 1955, Van Nyman was arrested on fraud charges brought by the investors of his Westmoreland expedition. In 1957, Jim and Nancy Sawtell arrived in Frankfort, Michigan and spent more than a decade looking for the Westmoreland. The Sawtells are best known for creating shipwreck restaurant interiors and shipwreck furniture, which was sold in the Leland and Charlevoix areas. The 1960s, 70s, 80s, and 90s brought around a dozen treasure hunting expeditions to northern Michigan, but no claims of finding the ship or her treasures. On July 7, 2010, while side-scanning the waters near Sleeping Bear Dune, I ran over a large, ship-shaped target in nearly 200 feet of water. 3 days later, I journeyed back to the site to dive the mysterious underwater object. It was just me and my brother Bob on the boat. My plan was to dive down to the object, and if it was the Westmoreland, film the hogging arches, which would positively identify the target as the Westmoreland. We hooked the object, I suited up, and down the line I went. I looked down, and below me I saw the bow of an enormous ship. I only had a brief moment to look, then I went back to the ritual of clearing my ears, inflating my dry suit, and aiming my camera. I slowly made my way aft, surveying the wreck, and pondering if I was the first one to see this in the last 150 years. The forward cabins and pilot house were missing, and I saw the mast broken off about 6 feet above the deck. It was the same diameter as your typical telephone pole. The arches came into view. They rose about 12 feet above the deck, the passenger railing perfectly intact. There was a brace connecting the arches, a round tube about 6 inches in diameter. I reached out a hand and touched it. As I passed by, it was covered in quagga mussels. The deck appeared to be collapsed between the arches. I continued towards the stern. I wanted to see if the engine and boiler were still there, or if she was salvaged. in 1874, as a newspaper report said. In the distance, the lifeboat davits appeared, the cranes used to launch the lifeboats. And there was a smokestack base, the smokestack plenum with a boiler right below it, and the engine cylinder right behind that, covered with a piece of deck, and those davits that came about 14 feet off the deck. The ship wasn't salvaged. I decided to go to the very stern. And out of the gloom appeared the auxiliary helm, a perfectly intact 4-foot ship's wheel. A single word raced through my mind, virgin. This was the Westmoreland, and she was a virgin wreck. Over the next 2 years, the Westmoreland revealed herself to us, her legend, her history, and her wreck site, an underwater museum, an ice water time capsule. The Westmoreland has been lying on the bottom of Lake Michigan, unmolested, since 1854.
Wow, just a great story. Very exciting find. That was my first major shipwreck discovery. This is art by Cal Cothrati, and he really captures the spookiness. We consider these shipwrecks underwater haunted houses, yet they can contain such history, and he's really able to sum it up in his painting. Well, onto this part of the program, we'll call this the South Manitou snorkeling trip. Now, I hang out a lot around Manitou Island because they're so close to home. So it's maybe a 20-minute ride towing the boat from Lake Ann to Glen Arbor right here where I launch, and we run out to the islands. Now, my cousins were visiting a couple years ago, and they said, hey, can you take us out to South Manitou Island? And I said, sure, but I want to test out my new sonar. Well, there they are right there, Bobby and Brenda King from Hayhira, Georgia. And I said, let me throw the sonar in the water and test it out because I wanted to get a little time in and scan some of the bottom. And wouldn't you know what? We ran across something on the bottom. Here's the first look at something. It's right here, this little white dot. I knew it was something. Again, this was probably a quarter mile. Whew. Here, so that's quite a long range, but I knew I had a significant target that I needed to go back and look at. And we did that about a week later. I took my family to North Manitou Island where we snorkel. That's my son, Mason, jumping in. He's a little older, a little bigger now. And that wreck is the Supply, which is off North Manitou Island. It wrecked right about the Civil War time. She was carrying bricks for the blast furnace in Leland. We're out there with our friends, the Swanks. There's Connor, and she's in 12 feet of water again. Beautiful, clear, 70-foot visibility. This is the kind of stuff we just go out and do. Again, bricks are still laying down there. What a great fun. But, oh, wait a minute. On the way out, we stopped by the wreck site, and I ran my sonar again, and I came up with this image. Now, something spiked off the bottom 90 feet, which is extremely unusual for a sonar image. And I came across this and I recognized it. I had this picture at home. I said, oh my goodness, I've got a sail vessel and it looks like the masts are up all the way. 90 feet off the bottom is almost unheard of in a shipwreck. So I called my buddy, Steve Weimer. Steve is a great friend of mine and Cal Cothrati's, and I said, Steve, I've got a wreck in about 300 feet of water. Can you go down there and take some pictures of it so we can try to figure out what it is? We just don't know what it is. So he came over. It was early October. Here's the boat ramp we use. And of course, after a storm, it's right on Lake Michigan, so the boat ramp gets covered in seaweed and garbage. So there we are. It took about 15 minutes of cleaning up fish carcasses and seaweed before we got to go out there. But Steve captured these images right at fall to kind of to tell us what was down there. And these are our first looks at this mystery shipwreck. Okay, we're heading towards the stern of a small sailing vessel. Steve estimated the length at about 60 to 70 feet. Cabin intact. usually the cabin breaks off during the sinking. The air pressure blows off or the waves. Ship's wheel fully intact. There, look at that cabin. We have a door here. And the ship's wheel is there. Everything is there on the vessel. Let's take a look at the more of the yawl boat right at the stern. She actually sank with the yawl boat connected. She was connected by hemp rope, and those probably rotted away after 10 or 20 or 30 years. And the vessel fell right to the stern, and there we see the rudder of this mystery vessel. So I love a good mystery. And these vessels no longer have the names written on them, so we had to find out. Okay, great shot of the stern. And the masts are totally upright, including the top mast. This is very rare. You could count on one hand the vessels that still have their top masts. Okay, lots of wreckage there. Again, very dark this day. It was in the fall, and again, this is in 300 feet of water. Okay, more wreckage there. So we had some things to work with to help describe it. So I went to my old standbys, online databases. One is called the Metzler Collection. The other is called the Labadee Collection. They're both available online, and they have thousands and thousands of shipwreck records. Well, I eventually came across one that could have fit. It was a 70-foot clipper bow schooner, which this vessel had a clipper bow on it, named the Emily, which disappeared in 1857. Wow. Okay. Zoom, you're killing me tonight. Man. Well, sorry, folks. Let me restart this. So, the thing with the Emily was she was a pre-Civil War vessel. Now, the vessel we found had iron rope on it. We could see part of the rigging was iron rope. Now, the significance is they didn't start using that until after the Civil War in the Great Lakes. So we knew we had a vessel that was later than that in the Great Lakes. So I had to go back to the database, which took me quite a while to do. I probably spent two to three hours a night for approximately 3 weeks and went through every record until I found one that fit. Let's see here. Let's get to that. And you're probably looking at a screen right now, I'm hoping. So over 6,000 records searched, and the ones that were close, I had to cross-reference with newspaper. It was very laborious. And of course, the one I found that fit it didn't start with A or B, it started with W, and it was the W.C. Kimball, which was out of Northport, Michigan, which is the very tip of the Leelanau Peninsula. She disappeared in 1891, allegedly near Point Betty. And the story of the W.C. Kimball is she was built in 1888 in Manitowoc, Wisconsin, with a clipper bow. She was sold to parties in Northport in 1889, I believe, and they used her for a small coastal schooner. And in 1891, she was making the first run of the year. Now, it was April. Maybe May. Let me see here. Yep, she left port in mid-May of 1891. Now, the water was still in the 35-degree temperature range, so very cold water, even though you get good weather. Now, in Northport, they grow potatoes. She was carrying a load of potatoes to Chicago. She unloaded the potatoes, and one of the crewmen by the name of Henry Budd, he was kind of an accident-pro guy, he was injured. So the rest of the crew, which consisted of Captain James Stevens, who was age 42, and Charles Keel, the first mate, age 27, and their friend William Wolfe, who was a newspaper guy, not even a sailor, he was a salon, they took the boat to Manistee, and they picked up a young immigrant by the name of Carl Andreessen, who was only 19 years old, and they loaded up with salt in Manistee and a load of shingles on the deck and decided to sail back to Northport and they took off from port. The weather was a little rough and they simply vanished. And only a few pieces of wreckage were found. No bodies were ever found. Now the W.C. Kimball, we do have some images of what the W.C. Kimball looked like to help us identify her. There's a picture of her bow in the lower right-hand or lower left-hand corner right there. So she had some, she was very small. Again, that clipper bow. There's a great shot of her right there at port with her crew on board, the men who were lost with her. Again, beautiful little elegant sailing vessel, little coastal schooner, gorgeous vessel. So we put together a crew of us. Brent Tompkins, he is the owner of the White Shoal Light in Northern Lake Michigan. Brian Dort is next to him going from left to right in the green hat. He is going to operate the ROV for this trip. The guy with all the scuba gear, his name is Steve Weimer. And Cal Kothrati's in the yellow slicker, and I got to play captain for this adventure. So let's take a look at what we were able to come up with. This is from the ROV. Again, beautiful, beautiful footage of the masts are upright on this. This is one of the most intact shipwrecks we have ever seen. Again, we're gonna drop in at the very stern here. Arriving at the stern, and there we are. And just sitting on the bottom of the yaw boat, staying at the stern, attached when she sank. What creates a mystery? We love mysteries and shipwrecks. Why the yaw boat still sitting at the stern? Looking, everything looks intact. We're looking for damage. That probably happened during the sinking. There, that looks like the gaff right here. On the main mast. White thing is like grapple. We have to grapple these wrecks. Okay, cabin, very intact. This is our first look inside the cabin. No one has seen in here since 1891. Okay, toggling to the ROV. Steve's down there, but we do have a robot down there with him. And this is the view from the robot and Steve's dive lights right there. Steve starts moving up towards the bow. So we thought if there were two remains, they would be in this cabin. We didn't get a good shot right here. Steve's gonna take a turn and start heading towards the bow. Hatch covers in place. Again, the hatch covers usually blow off during the sinking. There we are. The booms and gaffs are still in place on this wreck. All the sailing hardware is there. It's like she sank under sail. And the sails rotted, the canvas sails, it maybe took 10 years, 20 years to rot away, and those are gone, leaving all the hardware still there. Hemp rope, again, is gone, but the standing rigging, which would have been iron rope, is all still there. All right, heading towards the bow, we see the chain plates and dead eyes. The anchor, again, no damage to the hull. We're looking for collision damage. Did she hit an iceberg? We just don't see anything. So that's a mystery. Why did this vessel sink? All right, we're gonna loop around and see Brian Dort's Blue Robotics ROV, the robot that can go down deep and look at some of these shipwrecks. And we're going to toggle the view and take a look at some of Steve's dive gear. Again, he's covered in head to toe with dive gear to go down 300 feet. He's diving with a rebreather, which is the same technology that astronauts use. And he probably has seven different tanks with seven different breathing gases on there. So he has to be very careful. He's very knowledgeable. Not only is it tricky to dive at this depth, you also have to be an underwater videographer. So operating a camera with lights and all the settings, a very daunting task. But Steve is a heck of a pro. I'm lucky to have somebody like this that can able to pop down in there and see what these mystery wrecks are. Okay, the windlass and the boom still attached to the foremast. Wow. All the sailing hardware right down there. It's like you could clean that all up and she would sail again. Hatch cover still in place. Very unusual for the hatch cover to be in place. Usually those blow off with the air pressure. Starting to figure belt. What happened here? The cabin's still there. The hatches are still there. What would hold everything in place? We think she was covered in ice. We think she got caught in gale and was covered in ice. And if you look at the railing there, that is only knee high, maybe less. If they were in a gale, that's not going to offer protection for the crew. The waves are going to crash right over to the side of that, and especially if things are icy, they're going to wash everybody overboard. So that's exactly what we think happened. One by one, the crew was washed overboard until she became a ghost ship and sank, entombed in ice right where she is now. That's why she's in such beautiful shape. We're coming up. There's a bilge pump there ahead of the cabin. And we're thinking if there were human remains, that's where they would be. We're taking a peek inside now. A few objects in there. But he made the decision to go to the back. He didn't want to send him into the cabin. That's way too dangerous. We wanted him to look in through the doors, but not go inside. And beautifully intact shipwreck. For being 130 years old. There's the steering box right there. Rudder post. And oh, look at that. The yawl boat right where it sat. They would hang the yawl boat off the stern. Not only was it a lifeboat, when these boats anchored in port, because there wasn't always a lot of dock room, they'd use that yawl boat to go to shore. So again, ship's wheel still there, steering box. This is the robot's view, watching Steve heading towards the cabin to get a look inside. Patterns in the silk there. Maybe there's a chair with a broken leg. No kind of human remains. We thought if there were human remains here, they would be in the cabin. But the theory is everybody was washed overboard. That's why they didn't try to use the yawl boat. Sure, they were within sight of multiple shorelines. But we don't think anybody was on the boat to try to access them. Now the grapple, look how close the grapple is to the ship's wheel again. Grappling wrecks from a football field above, totally blind, and just try to snag something and hope you don't damage artifacts, especially a beautiful wreck like this. So Steve is done with his dive. He's going to head to the surface. For a dive of that length, of that duration, he's going to have about an hour of decompression time. And that water is 39 degrees down there. So Alcatrati created this image of the Kimball wreck site, really capturing the beauty of this elegant little coastal schooner. And very detailed up front, we can see Steve there filming it. And the quagga mussels are even added to it. And it really captures the feel of these Great Lakes vessels. It's one of the ways we can share visually what these shipwrecks. Now, I love the history. Cal's able to share the visuals of it. Steve's able to provide it with this information. There's a painting of the W.C. Kimball that hangs in the Northport Area Museum. Again, this town was devastated by the loss of three of its young members. Well, thank you for coming out tonight and exploring some of these mysteries of our Great Lakes region and some of these shipwreck discoveries. I hope you enjoyed and have a good evening. I'll be sticking around for questions now. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much, Ross. Just before anybody leaves, I'd like to remind everybody that our summer reading code today is LAKE, L-A-K-E, without any caps. So if you're participating, just go to Beanstack and enter this code for an extra ticket. All right. Are there any questions?
Feel free to unmute your mic if you'd like to ask in person, and you can turn your screen on also if you want to be seen. Let me see here. I don't see any questions in the chat.
I don't either. I can start everybody off. How long does it take you to put a dive together once you find a scan that's has potential to be a shipwreck?
It actually takes quite a while because Steve, you know, has a job and he lives in Minnesota now. So we have to figure out a time. And as you know, the Big Lake does not cooperate a lot. Maybe 2 days out of a week you can get out there. So you have to get really lucky. Last year we went out to look at a target and it was really bad, but it was the only time we could get out and look at it. We still haven't seen it yet. Okay. So it can be difficult. But, you know, we plan months in advance. Right now, we started planning stuff in January, February. And the logistics are really tough to get a boat out to the site, hook the site. And that's not including the side scan time, because you don't just go out and find a shipwreck. I probably scan for 200 or 300 hours of sonar in the water per shipwreck. And sometimes that takes a year or two or three to get that amount of time to find a shipwreck. So it's pretty laborious, but we're passionate about it. We just love this stuff, and that's why we do it.
That's really interesting. Does anyone else have a question they'd like to ask?
Well, I must have did my job because nobody has any questions. I must have answered all the questions ahead of time.
I think so. Well, thank you, Ross. It was very interesting. I had no idea this whole underwater world existed with like hidden stories. So
yeah, lots of good stuff. And you know, there's hundreds of shipwrecks that haven't been discovered yet. So we look forward to finding some of them and sharing their histories with people.
That's very exciting. Well, thank you. And there will be a recording of this available for 4 weeks, probably within a couple of days. So.
All right. Thanks. Good night.
Good night. Take care, everybody.